I'm Chris Stecker. I'm the Master Gardener Program Coordinator and the Horticulture Technician for Alamance County Cooperative Extension Service. Today we're going to talk about propagating woody plants. So this will be your shrubs and trees around the yard. We have several different methods, and we're going to discuss them first here, and then maybe we'll do a little bit hands-on. So, first of all, we've got a couple methods we're going to talk about today: ground layering, air layering, and cuttings, which is actually the most used method. And ground layering, which sometimes happens on its own. If you have a lot of shrubbery, like azaleas will do this, and hydrangeas, where the branches touch the ground, you may realize when you're picking them up to weed or whatever that they've actually already rooted into the ground. You can cut that off at the mother plant and have a new plant. So it's an easy way to propagate azaleas, rhododendrons, and hydrangeas. You can do it. You can do it on purpose rather than having it happen as an accident. If you've got these low-hanging branches, like on this hydrangea, so be on the ground, just clear the mulch away so you expose the soil, and break up the soil a little bit. And then this is important, you wound the branch. Now, in nature, this probably doesn't happen when it happens naturally, but you're going to encourage it to form roots at this wound. So that's where you would wound it. And then pin it or weight it. You can use a brick. You can use, that's a greening pin. You can use that, anything. Keep it in contact with the soil.
Okay.
And then you
wait. How did you wound the branch?
I'm sorry?
How did you wound the branch? I mean, you just do a little cutting or something somewhere else?
It just scratched a little bit.
Oh, okay.
Scratch. You want to scratch the phloem and the cambium.
And it needs to be on the side that's going to the soil.
Right, that surface will touch the soil.
Okay.
And then you wait. Sometimes it'll take 6 months to a year. But then you can see that it has formed roots here. And you're going to cut cut it away from the mother plant, leaving the roots with the new plant. This is the new plant over here. This, the mother plant's off in this direction. And then you just shovel it. And when I did this, the soil was very, very wet. This is probably not the best soil to be working in, but it was one of those springs where we had a lot of rain. Okay, so you're just going to dig it up, and then you're going to plant it basically the way it was growing in the ground, and you'll have a new plant.
Cool.
Air layering.
What's the best time to do this?
Any time where it's actively growing. You could do it right now. You could do it in the winter, too. It probably would be less... it probably won't start growing roots until it's soil temperature is right for it. So,
Chris, are there particular things that are good to do that with? In other words, particular plants that are
anything that has a low any plant that has low growing branch, hydrangeas. On your handout, there is a this is for cuttings, but any of those plants would also work this way if the branch can touch the ground. Obviously, if your maple tree, it's going to be really difficult to get the branch to touch the ground. However, your Japanese maple that has very low-hanging branches, you might try it with that. Nothing lost if it doesn't work, because you haven't really spent a lot of energy or time on it. Okay. This way, we're going to do basically the same thing as the ground layering, only we're going to do it in the air. So this would work better on a tree. So we're inducing a part of a woody plant to develop roots by wounding the stem and enclosing it in moist moss. Some candidates, again, rhododendrons, camellias, azaleas, hollies, magnolias, fruit trees. This is a good thing to do. Apples, pears, pecans, grapevines. I know that Benjamin Vineyards, they do this with their own grapevines. And roses. And believe it or not, bonsai specimens, you know, the real gnarly bonsai, many times are taken as air layers from an interesting old tree that has an interesting branch. So they air layer off that branch and then start it in its own bonsai pot. So it's an ancient system that's been used by the Chinese and Japanese for centuries. So you pick a branch about the size of a pencil or a little bit bigger. This is a camellia. You wound the stem, and this is a kind of a precise way of wounding the stem. And you're gonna take a sharp knife and make two parallel cuts I'll show you some pictures of this, because this may not make sense until you see it. About two times the diameter of the branch apart, around the stem and through the bark and the cambium layer. Connect the two parallel cuts with one long cut. Remove the ring of bark, leaving the inner woody tissue exposed. And this is how it's going to work. We're going to make a cut here, a cut here, a cut down here, and you're going to peel off this bark. It'll peel off very easily. All the way around. Okay, so here's me doing that. I didn't even cut myself, so that's how easy it is. When I first started looking into this, one of the things said, use a knife, it doesn't have to be sharp. And I thought, that sounds like a bad idea. So I recommend a sharp knife.
Yes.
And there's the cutting there. I'm going to cut, you see the little ring I made there, the little ring made there, and I'm going to make a slice down there. And then I'm peeling off, see how easily that peels off. And then one thing you want to do is, this green here, this is actually the cambium layer of the plant, or part of it. And what might happen if you don't scrape that off is, it might actually try to heal itself and not grow roots. It'll grow more bark instead of growing roots. So you want to scrape that off. You want to get down to just the xylem, the center part of the stem. I'll give you a little botany here. The stem is the bark, which is the phloem basically, and then the cambium, which is this greenish layer here, and those two things are where the action happens. And then the xylem, which is the center part. So it's one takes water up, water up, one takes energy from the sun down. So anyway, you want to make it so that you've interrupted that whole cycle. Because then you've got that, and you may not need to do this, but you can apply a rooting hormone, which is an auxin, and we're going to talk about that some more when we talk about cuttings to the wound. And then you're going to apply a handful of damp sphagnum moss that you've squeezed the moisture out of. You want to use sphagnum moss rather than peat moss, because peat moss is just basically powder. Sphagnum moss will hold the moisture better. And then tie it in place, wrap clear plastic around the sphagnum moss several times and secure it with electrician's tape at the top and bottom. And we want the seal to be such that excess water can escape, but moisture will be retained. And then wrap the whole thing with a sheet of aluminum foil with a dull side out. And this you do because the roots are not going to grow toward sunlight, which will be available to it through the plastic wrap. So you put the foil on to keep it dark, but you want this dull side out to keep the birds from pecking on it, because they won't see the reflection as easily. So here's me doing. By the way, this is really hard. So I have another way. So this is what I did. And that's your finished package after that. But there's an alternative method. This method is easier for a person doing it on their own with no help. Take a quart-sized plastic storage bag and open it up, cut down one side, cut across the bottom so you open up like a book, and if it's a Ziploc, you want to cut that part off. Gather the bottom and fasten it to the to the stem underneath your wound and tie it with a rubber band that has been cut. A rubber band that's cut in half makes, or cut open, makes a great little baby bungee cord. So you just tie that on there. And then you pack the pocket with your damp sphagnum moss and tie off the top of the second split rubber band after wrapping the bag around it, and make sure the package is tight. It's a little harder to tighten the bag than it is saran wrap. And then wrap it with aluminum foil with the doll side out again. I brought a branch in so I could demonstrate this. There's my wounded stick with the bag under it. You gather it up like that, put your moss in, and make a nice little package. Wrap it with foil, and then you check it and wait. Check periodically to make sure it's still moist. You can sort of tell by feel. After about 8 weeks, you peel back the foil to see if you should be able to see the white roots coming, so you can, they're visible through the plastic. And when it's rooted, then you cut it off from the parent plant below your package. Carefully remove the plastic without disturbing the roots or removing the ball of moss. Leave the ball of moss there. And then you can plant it in a container filled with a moist potting mix, or you can plant it in a well-prepared soil bed. If when you unwrap it, there are roots, but it's a little bit dried out, you might want to soak the whole thing in a bucket of water for an hour or so, just to rehydrate it in case it's dried out some. Okay, so that's it for air layering. Let's talk about cutting.
So you can plant it directly in the ground?
You can. As long as your bed is well prepared. I would not put it in just the heavy clay soil.
So it'd be on the north side of the house, or any preferences?
Well, whatever situation the original plant was growing in. Because the good thing about this is, by the way, I didn't even tell you, when you do the air layering, you would like to have something that's about 18 inches to 2 feet long, not much more than that. Now, whatever situation that plant was growing in is still growing in that situation because it's right there. You don't have to harden it off. It'll still be in that light situation. So just want to make sure that you keep it watered because it's been moist.
Is it a good idea to have the top part above it have a lot of leaves and everything so that...
Oh, that's a good point. Good point. She asked if you need to have a lot of leaves on it, and it would be a good idea to remove some of the foliage when you plant it. You can leave all the leaves on there when you're trying to grow roots on it, but when you plant it, you would like to remove some of the foliage at least, in order to keep it pressure off the root system. So you want the root system to be able to grow without having to support a whole lot of leaves. It should be fine, but just remove some of the leaves. You leave some leaves because it still has to photosynthesize. Okay, so when you take new plants from cuttings, there's three types of cuttings. There's softwood, which is soft, succulent, new growth of woody plants just as it begins to harden. And you're going to see a lot of that out here today because we're kind of early in the season for taking cuttings. Shoots will snap easily when bent, and the youngest leaves have not quite reached mature size. Semi-hardwood, which is what we're really looking for most of the plants that are on the list today, is this year's growth, the wood has matured, and the leaves are full size. So those are semi-hardwood cuttings. Hardwood cuttings are shoots that grew last summer, and you're going to want to take these cuttings in while the plant is still dormant, usually. So what we're looking for today are semi-hardwood and those cuttings should work for you today. So I underline that. Okay, the basics. We want to make sure that we minimize water loss. So you want to make sure that the plants are watered the night before. We want to prevent disease. We want to encourage root formation. And here's how we're going to do that. You want to start with well-hydrated cuttings. And of course, the best way to do that is to water the day before. However, we've had so much rain, I think you will find that all the plants in the garden are well hydrated. Mm-hmm. And you want to take the cutting in the morning. That'll keep it, make sure it has, it's turgid and it has all the water in it. Process the cutting immediately or stand the cut end in water. Decrease the leaf surface by removing most of the leaves. Use a pre-moistened medium and water well after sticking the cuttings. And then enclose the pot and the cuttings in a plastic bag to keep the maintain the humidity. You want to keep it out of direct sunlight. A good thing to do with that is to put it outdoors, but put it behind your shrub border. prevent disease. Take cuttings only from healthy plants. Use clean tools and pots. Excuse me. And clean with a 10% bleach solution. Rinse and let dry. Use a fresh, soilless potting mix. Keep it moist, but not waterlogged. And then encourage root formation by selecting robust shoots. Leave enough leaves for photosynthesis. And you stimulate root formation by applying a synthetic form of auxin, which is a naturally occurring plant hormone. And this will stimulate roots to grow on your cutting. Keep them warm, but avoid excessive heat. Okay, so these are some old hair pictures of Mark. Mark's not been available to do some new pictures for us. So. But this is how you do it. You take a cutting, you can take a cutting that has flowers on it, that's fine. And you want to cut off the flower. And now he's got a nice little cutting there. Look, it's just one leaf. One leaf left. And here's this is a PG hydrangea, which is one of the ones that's on the list for today. And this is more of a softwood cutting. I'm gonna take all those leaves off, or most of those leaves off. And you're gonna even cut those. Take those leaves and cut them in half, because those are big leaves and they take a lot of moisture. So here's now this is a pout. We're going to be using a liquid rooting hormone, which is this basically a solution of this material. And we're going to take our soilless medium and we're going to poke some holes in it, because we want to not wipe the rooting hormone off the cuttings. So this one is dipped in a powder one. We're going to dip our cuttings in this about 1 inch into these little cups of not juice. This is the rooting hormone. And leave it in for about 3 to 5 seconds. That's all you need to do. And then you're going to put it in one of your pre-drilled holes. And then we've got the coat hangers here will make a little framework to support the plastic bag that's going to go over the top to keep the moisture in.
Should all these cuttings be the same plant? Or could
they can be different plants. The pots you have today, I would not put any more than 3 cuttings in there, because this is a little bit wider pot. That's about all it'll hold. But you can put 3 different kinds of plants in there if you want. And then you wrap it up in a plastic bag and put it in a warm but not hot place. And there you go. And this, if you want more information about propagating this Extension Gardener Handbook, at that website has got a great chapter on propagation and includes propagating from seeds and everything I talked about today. And that will get us onto our next thing. So I'm going to move over to the table and basically demonstrate what we're going to be doing outside, except I forgot to take a cutting. Maybe we should take our cuttings first. Yeah, I think I better run out and get a cutting. Okay. So, moving right along. shouldn't have run there. Okay.
She's gonna go grab some cuttings.
I actually think this plant is on the list. Okay, we're gonna take this. This is Osmanthus fragrans. And I'm gonna take a cutting, not very big. And I'm going to cut. I'm gonna first fill my pot. I'm using, each of these pots has a coffee filter in it that keeps the soil from falling out the bottom of the pot. We're nothing if not tidy. Oh, by the way, if you find some ants in your potting mix, don't be alarmed. They're not fire ants. So this potting mix has not been pre-moistened. All of the potting mix in those has been pre-moistened. So you're going to pre-moisten this, and what we did was water it and let it stand in water for just about an hour, and then drain it, and that should give you about the right level of moisture. So now we've got this potting mix, and we'll take a pencil, and I'm going to drill three holes because I'm going to do three cuttings, but right now I'm just going to do one. And I'm going to take a cutting here. This looks like a pretty good cutting. And I'm going to take off all these lower pieces. And I'm going to take off some of this upper stuff. And let's see. We'll get it down to almost nothing. Okay, it's a pretty good cutting. Looks like it has a little winter damage on it. Okay, so then I'm going to take this cutting, a little cup of rooting hormone here. I'm gonna leave it in 1, 2, 3. Stick it in the hole. You're going to put it in about an inch deep, a little bit more, and just firm the potting mix around it. And then I'll demonstrate how to make these tents. It's pretty easy. And just a little bit of tape there to keep it from sliding apart. And then, the plastic bags. Just go with these. You really don't want to have this be in direct sun, because the plastic bag could act like a little terrarium and heat things up on the inside and make it miserable for your soon to be new plant. So we're just going to put that tent on there, and you can gather it around the bottom. We're mostly just trying to keep it humid in there. You want to keep the plastic from touching the leaves of the plant, so to put them more closer to the center. So you don't want anything to touch the leaves. And then you're going to wait. It can take a couple months before you start having roots. The way you would check after a couple months is gently, I'll show you how you would do that, just gently pull on it. I mean that by gently, I mean just gently. See, right now, of course, it comes right now. But if you gently pull on it and it resists, it means it's probably making roots. So that's what we're going to do. So now, if you want to do this, does anybody want to propagate some plants from the garden?
Yeah.
Okay. you've got cuttings that are more softwood than hardwood, I would, I want to further dilute your mix. So if you need a do-over, because some of the ones that are softwood, when you mix this up, you mix it according to what kind of cutting you're rooting, and that could include, if it's a softwood cutting, it would be a weaker solution than a hardwood solution.
Usually about two per month. So I think Green Thursday's class schedule. All different kinds of gardening topics. So we've done pruning. We'll have a class on vegetable gardening. We'll have a class on birds. We have a rain garden class, drought tolerant plants, fall lawn care. It's quite a long list of gardening classes we provide to the public to give them a better understanding of different gardening topics. All our classes are free, and they're held at 10 o'clock on Thursday morning here in the Ag Building.